Hi there, I hope you're well. It's Miss Barbara here. This lesson is titled Flaws of Apportionment Methods. Webster's defines paradox as a statement that is contradictory or opposed to common sense, and yet is perhaps true. We now examine some paradoxical consequences that result from the choice of an apportionment method. The Alabama paradox. Example 1. Use Hamilton's method to apportion seats between the states Austin, Belton, and Canton as represented in the following tables if there are 10 congressional seats. In Hamilton's method, we begin by finding the standard divisor. That standard divisor is the entire population. In this instance, it's 140, divided by the number of items to be apportioned. That's 10 congressional seats. So the standard divisor here is 14. To get the standard quota, let's say for Austin, you take the Austin population of 60, divide it by 14, have your calculator handy. This result is 4.286, and since Belton's population is the same, we know that the standard quota for Belton is also 4.286. In your calculator, quickly compute 20 divided by 14 to get Canton's standard quota, and that turns out to be 1.429. In Hamilton's method, we start by first taking the lower quota of each area. So Austin gets 4, Belton gets 4, and Canton gets 1. Add those together and the result is 9, which means we still have one unaccounted for congressional seat. The surplus allocation goes to the state or property or territory with the highest residual. Residual is the biggest fractional part, and in this instance, it's Canton. So Canton gets that surplus allocation. Then the final apportionment, Austin gets 4, Belton gets 4, and Canton gets 2. Let's do the same problem, but for 11 congressional seats. Then the standard divisor here would be the total population, which is 140, and divide it by the number of items to be split up evenly, that's 11 congressional seats, and we'll round this to 12.73. In your calculator, we'll solve for the standard quotas. Start with for Austin, 60, divide that by 12.73, that's 4.71. We don't need to compute it again for Belton because it's the same population. And in your calculator, compute 20, divide it by 12.73, and that quotient is 1.57. Hamilton's method, we take the lower quota for each of the areas. So Austin has 4, Belton has 4, and Canton has 1. Add up all of those seats, and that's 9, and with 11 seats, we have 2 unaccounted for legislative seats. We divvy those up to the states with the highest fractional portion, and this time it turns out to be Austin and Belton. The final apportionment with 11 congressional seats, Austin gets 5, Belton gets 5, and it appears that Canton gets 1, so with one more congressional seat, Canton has less overall. Canton lost a seat. What just happened is known as the Alabama paradox. The Alabama paradox states an increase in the total number of items to be apportioned results in a loss of an item for a group. That is paradoxical. Be sure to answer the historical context of this paradox to complete your notes. The population paradox. Example, Gryffindor, Hufflepuff, and the little-known Imperius houses have each grown over time. The board apportions 30 seats among the above-listed houses. Use Hamilton's method to apportion the seats. Before growth populations, Gryffindor had 100, Hufflepuff had 85, Imperius 10, so the total population was 195. To do this problem using Hamilton's method, we begin by first finding the standard divisor, which is computed as the total population, that's 195, divided by the number of items to be apportioned, and that would be 30 seats. That quotient is 6.5. Now, in your calculator, we're going to compute the standard quotas for each of the houses. Let's start with Gryffindor. 100 divided by 6.5. That's 15.38. Do this again with 85 divided by 6.5. That's 13.08. And for Imperius, 10 divided by 6.5, result is 1.54. In Hamilton's method, we take the lower quota. Gryffindor starts out with the lower quota of 15, Hufflepuff with 13, and Imperius with 1. Add those up, 15 plus 13 plus 1, that's 29. We have 30 seats. So we have one more to allocate, and it goes to the house with the highest residual on the standard quota. That turns out to be Imperius. So the final apportionment, Gryffindor gets 15, Hufflepuff 13, and Imperius gets 2. For a total of 30, our desired amount. A couple of years later, there are aftergrowth populations. Gryffindor increased to 107, Hufflepuff to 86, and Imperius to 11 for a whole new population of 204. To use Hamilton's method, we need to find a new standard divisor. We compute that by taking the total 204 and dividing it by the number of items to be apportioned, which is still only 30. So the standard divisor with the aftergrowth populations is 6.8. Now we find the standard quotas for each of the houses. In your calculator, key in 107 divided by 6.8. And you get 15.74 for Hufflepuff, 86 divided by 6.8. The result, 12.65. Imperius, 11 divided by 6.8 to two decimal places, 1.62. Now the lower quota for each of the houses, Gryffindor, 15, Hufflepuff, 12, and Imperius, 1. 15 plus 12 plus 1 is 28. So now we have two unassigned seats, and they go to the house whose standard quota has the highest residual. That's the decimal part. So the first one goes to Gryffindor because it's 0.74. The next one goes to Hufflepuff with the 0.65. Now, the final apportionment becomes 16 for Gryffindor, stays the same for Hufflepuff as before, 13, and Imperius goes down to 1. Interestingly enough, Imperius grew at a faster rate. Imperius grew 10%. Gryffindor grew only at a rate of 7%. Imperius grew at a faster rate. Even so, Imperius lost a seat, Gryffindor gained one. What just happened? It's known as the population paradox. It says Group A loses items to Group B, even though the population of Group A grew at a faster rate than that of Group B. Be sure to answer the historical context of this paradox to complete your notes. And now we have something called the New States paradox. Example, a new state, Fresno, is introduced into a country with existing states, Daytona and Eugene. Its Congress had 50 seats with two states and increased the number to 57 when Fresno joined. Use Hamilton's method to apportion the seats. So we'll start with when we only had two states. So I'll block off the place for the third. We begin with Hamilton's method by finding the standard divisor, which is the total population here of 502. And we divide that by the number of seats to be apportioned, which is 50. The standard divisor is 10.04. Now we'll find the standard quota for Daytona. In your calculator, compute 427 divided by 10.04, accurate to two decimal places. That's 42.53. And 75 divided by 10.04, accurate to two decimal places, is 7.21. In Hamilton's method, you pick the lower quota as a starting point. So pick 42 for Daytona, 7 for Eugene. Add those seats together. That's 49. So we still have one unassigned seat, and that gets given to the state that has the highest residual. That's the fractional part, and Daytona's is 0.53. Eugene follows 0.21, so Daytona gets that surplus, and the final apportionment, 43 for Daytona and 7 for Eugene, for a total of 50, our desired amount. Let's see what happens after Fresno joins these states. Fresno joins with a population of 73, and the number of seats was increased from 50 to 57. We need a new standard divisor. And that's the total population is now 575. And we have 57 seats. Compute that in your calculator. Accurate to two decimal places. The standard divisor is 10.09. We need to find the standard quota for each of Daytona, Eugene, and Fresno. So let's compute. 427 divided by 10.09. Accurate to two decimal places. That's 42.32. Do that for Eugene. 75 divided by 10.09. Get 7.43. And do the same thing to get the standard quota for Fresno. Take 73 divided by 10.09. Accurate to two decimal places. That's 7.23. We're still using Hamilton's. So we take the lower quota, that's 42 for Daytona, 7 for Eugene, and 7 for Fresno. Add those together, that's 56. So we still have one unaccounted for seat. It goes to the town whose standard quota, the decimal is the largest, and in this case, That goes to Eugene. So Eugene gets the surplus and the final apportionment, Daytona 42, Eugene 8, and Fresno 7. And the sum is 57, which is the number of total seats. Daytona lost a seat. Somebody came in and Daytona lost a seat and Eugene gained a seat. What just happened is known as the new states paradox. The addition of a new group changes the apportionment of other previously existing groups. I encourage you to look up the historical context of where the new states paradox first occurred. Which brings us to Belinsky and Young's impossibility theorem, which state there is no perfect apportionment method. Any apportionment method that does not violate the quota rule must produce paradoxes, and any apportionment method that does not produce paradoxes must violate the quota rule.